This is the Gospel according to Matthew, the 22nd chapter.
Glory to you, Lord.
Once more, Jesus spoke to them in parables, saying, "The kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who gave a wedding banquet for his son. He sent his slaves to call those who had been invited to the wedding banquet, but they would not come. Again, he sent other slaves, saying, 'Tell those who have been invited, look, I have prepared my dinner, my oxen and my fat calves have been slaughtered, and everything is ready. Come to the wedding banquet.' But they made light of it and went away, one to his farm, another to his business, while the rest seized his slaves, mistreated them, and killed them. The king was enraged. He sent his troops, destroyed those murderers, and burned their city. Then he said to his slaves, 'The wedding is ready, but those who were invited were not worthy. Go therefore into the main streets and invite everyone you find to the wedding banquet.' Those slaves went out into the streets and gathered all whom they found, both good and bad, so the wedding hall was filled with guests. But the king came in to see the guests, and he noticed a man there who was not wearing a wedding robe. And he said to him, 'Friend, how did you get in here without a wedding robe?' And he was speechless. Then the king said to the attendants, 'Bind him hand and foot and throw him into the outer darkness, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. For many are called, but few are chosen.'" The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise you, Christ.
You may be seated. I've actually been out of town for a couple of weeks, but I do know that this is a recurring, this is a third story in this session of Gospels where there's this theme. Some are going to say yes, some are going to say no. Some of God's people will produce and others will not. Many are called, few are chosen. What we have the theme running through all of these is the fact that God is full of amazing love and grace. Because in all these stories, there is that sense of judgment, but there's also the sense of grace. So the last 2 weeks and today, we've heard from Jesus' parables about God's grace and the people who live in it, or refuse it, or choose not to pay attention to it. There are consistencies. I think the biggest one is that God's grace and invitation continue to be offered to everyone out there. The other consistency is that some of us, fail to figure it out, to accept it, to claim it. The nature of human beings is consistent across time as well. 2 weeks ago, there were the two sons. One agreed to do as his father asked, but he didn't do it. The other son said, no, but he does it anyway. Jesus told that story to the important church people, the one who spent a lot of time talking and saying they would do things, but not acting. He told them so that the undesirables who heard, believed, and repented, who followed John the Baptist, would actually get into heaven before these people who said what they didn't do. Actions continue to speak louder than words. To bring it to our time and for kind of our reflection, when have you or I said something and not done it? Or when have we done what was expected even when we hadn't planned to? One question. Last week there was the householder. He had a vineyard. When the workers failed to work, the owner sent his son. The workers killed him and the owner replaced all the workers. These were the ones who knew what they were doing, but they didn't do it. So new people come onto the scene when they were inexperienced and strangers. They were the outsiders, but they did what was needed and what was right. They produced. Stepping up to our time, when have you or I struggled with the task needed to be replaced? Or when are you and I have been an outsider who have completed the work God calls us to do? Questions to ponder. Today is the story of the wedding feast. There's a king who wants to celebrate his son's marriage, but those who were invited refused to come. There was still going to be a celebration, though that the king was sure of that. So everyone else was invited. The bad, the good, the worthy, the unworthy. And the king is going to make it possible by providing the right stuff, the right apparel to attend. People were to wear wedding gowns, wedding apparel. He People on the streets would not have had those necessarily, so the king was providing those so that anyone who was invited would come. And it all goes well until the king shows up at his own son's wedding reception and finds the one that wasn't wearing a wedding robe. Even though the guy had been offered what he needed, he didn't accept it. And so he was kicked out, bound hand and foot, and thrown into the fire. Sometimes even when we're given, when folks are given what they need, they still choose something else. When have you and I refused to accept an invitation of graciousness? When have you and I been included, to our surprise, maybe not our plan? When have you and I accepted the invitation but still failed to do what's expected? Again, more questions for us. But one of the things the writer Matthew does is remind us regularly in all different ways of God's amazing grace. That's what these stories are about. Strange and inappropriate people offered God's grace. Tax collectors and sinners, church leaders, family members, strangers, all recipients of that amazing grace. Of course, just like that time, some will accept and some will not. And yet, it's God's business, God's ultimate graciousness, God's offering to us. Nobody in these stories does anything to earn God's grace, but God gives it anyway. Who are we in the midst of all of these stories? Who are you? Who am I? Which group do we belong to? Are we the called, the chosen, the many, or the few? How do you bear fruit? These are the things that Scripture brings to us. We're called to think deeper, to consider more. And there are so many ways that the Spirit directs our hearing in these things. And that's the beauty of Scripture and of God's Word. Because it's always a challenge to better ourselves, to be more of what God intends us to be. But we also need to not worry so much about ourselves that we forget to recognize and celebrate the wonder of God's grace. Time and again, we're invited, we're implored, we're gifted. Regular old people, sinners and saints, gifted with God's love. Doesn't give us an out. We don't have to do other things because God loves us so much, but we need to not forget that we are so loved. Over and over and over in Matthew, the kingdom of heaven is offered to the unworthy, to the unexpecting, to the children, to the women, to the Gentiles, to you and to me. So, who's invited to your feast? Who's invited to our feast? Every Sunday, we invite everyone in this place, everyone who's present, to come to the communion feast. We don't check papers or membership or question someone on their way. We recognize that Jesus, in amazing grace, opened his table to all. Jesus says, come to me. And our job is just to welcome them in. Our job is to set a place and extend God's grace. There are congregations who aren't as good at that, and they have to make sure that you have been communed or baptized or everything else. We are doing as God says, extending the grace to those who need it. As a congregation, there have been folks in our building that we have opened this place to. We've invited them to the feast that is Alpine Lutheran. The Tamil-speaking community uses our facilities. People came in to help with the renovation and the cleaning of the basement. Others have asked to use our gift of space. Are we gracious in welcoming them in? Are we examples of God's grace saying, yes, we don't know who you are, we don't mind who you are, but come. Of course, there's probably those we forget to invite. There's probably those we choose not to invite. But that's the human nature, that's the human part of us that needs that reminder of who in fact God is doing, who in fact is doing the offering. It's not us, it's God. How often do we get caught up in the things of meager importance? Things that don't really matter. These are definitely examples for us. But throughout a world of difficulty, sometimes we just need to hear the words of grace and gospel. And that's what we hear by God continuing to invite and to call us and to say, here, come, be with us. Take my gifts. The passage from Philippians is actually a scolding. Paul is scolding these two women for their not being of the same mind, he says. The beginning of his letter to the Philippians is a very beautiful composition. And then at the end of this letter, Paul is scolding Euodia and Syntyche for being trivial. We're focusing on things that shouldn't really matter in the grand scheme of life. And here's this great disciple, the starter of the church in Philippi. He recognizes that they too have been called to the kingdom. They've been called to God's feast, but their hearts and their minds aren't where they belong. It's our story too, usually. It happens in the church, it happens in work, it happens in our families. Wherever people go, people can fail at being what God desires us to be, and yet God still graces us. Because that's where Jesus shows up. In the midst of that church in Philippi, Euodia and Syntyche were arguing about small things, but Jesus showed up. Paul spoke Jesus' words and said, "Come and be here. Put your mind on what's right. Do what you're called to do. Be there." The darkness is usually where Jesus and the brightness shows up best. In the darkness of our lives, the struggles and the trials, light does shine. Jesus shows up. When we have failed or rejected God's invitation to be at his feast, God in Jesus invites us again. The church is the way that Jesus shows us in this world. If the church didn't exist, Jesus wouldn't be as obvious. But the church isn't the structure. It's not the building. It's the people within this building. It's the people that worship, wherever it is they worship. Jesus shows up in the people of the church, the people in the church itself. Here's what we practice, where we practice what Christ calls us to be. There's a great, it's a Methodist pastor, he's at Duke University. His name is William Willimon, and he says it this way. He says, in the church, the little things make a difference. It's kind of the light shining in the dark world. Because it's in the little things that we get the glimpse of the kingdom of God. You and I don't live on cloud nine with words like humanity, soul, global, spiritual redemption. You live here. We live here, in this place, in this church, where the only glimmer of the kingdom is the one you get while standing next to ordinary people. We are the people that shine the light of Christ throughout this world. When you stand in this place, you are sharing a glimmer of the kingdom to those around you, those in front of you, the ones behind you. And when they look at you, they see a glimmer of the hope and the feast that God invites them to be. God continues to provide ordinary people with that chance of being a part of his kingdom, a part of his world, and the gifts he has to offer. So just like the characters in Matthew's stories, we're going to make mistakes, we're going to fail, and we're going to rely on God's grace to give us another chance. It's another chance for us, the ordinary people who fail to do as they said, the ones who don't produce, the ones who reject the invitation to the feast. And yet, that word of hope is that God does not fail. God's grace continues. God puts us in the middle of others to show us a glimmer of that kingdom in his graciousness for us. In our presence, our body, our very lives, we tell the stories of Christ and of God's amazing love and grace. Not just the pettiness and the deep, trivial details of life, though unfortunately those often come out. God continues to call us to show his amazing love and grace. He calls us to the greatest of meals, the greatest of celebrations, over and over and over again. And when we fail to be prepared, grace abounds. And God gives us what's necessary to show up and opens the door just a little bit wider the next time around. We are the ones who take God's hope and grace into this world, because many are called, many are invited, but few are chosen. Let us help the ones who invite those to come to us, those who need to see God's grace and God's beauty in this world. Many are called. You are chosen. But God is the one who opens that door for us. Thanks be to God.